As the smoke cleared from the rolling grasslands along the Little Bighorn River, the Lakota Sioux Indians celebrated their greatest victory over the white man. Although not present for the battle, the spiritual leadership of a legendary Lakota chief, Sitting Bull, was enough for him to be credited as the man who killed Custer. Revered as a holy man by the Lakota Sioux, it was said that he could communicate with animals and see visions of the future. Sitting Bull served as the military leader for all the Plains tribes, fighting the U.S. Army for control of his sacred homeland. Refusing to move his people to the white man's reservation, Sitting Bull consistently opposed the government and became the first nationally known defender of the rights of Native Americans.
He quickly emerged as the most important symbol of Sioux resistance, and of course remember that the Sioux are the most famous Indians of all American history. They're sort of the white man's Indian, the perfect Indian with feathered headdress, riding across the plains on beautiful ponies, hunting the buffalo. They're the very epitome of what the whites dreamed about an Indian being. And Sitting Bull is the great leader of those people.
My horse be swift in flight. Bear me now in safety far from the enemy's arrows. And you shall be rewarded with streamers and ribbons red. A Sioux warrior's song to his horse.
The Sioux Indian, proud and confident astride his beloved pony. It was not always so. Listen to the Sioux origin story of Joe flying by.
They were walking on foot, so they could not catch the buffalo, because the buffalo are very swift, and they are slow. They were very, very hungry. They went and stood on a hill, and they saw the wild horse, which is called sacred dog. They put some ropes on them, but nobody wanted to get on them because they were afraid of them. So they led them home.
The sacred dog of the Sioux totally revolutionized their culture.
In the early stages of this culture, they had relied on dogs for transportation, but that obviously greatly crippled their mobility. It was the horse that gave Indians the mobility that allowed them to follow the buffalo herds and live the nomadic life that they did.
The Sioux became much more prosperous. The horse was almost a unit of money. The more horses you had, the more wealthy you were.
With more pulling power, their portable teepees could become larger, and they could transport the old and the sick. But most importantly, they could hunt the buffalo as never before. With the horse, they could effectively chase the buffalo, escaping at full speed, and they could track the immense herds across hundreds of miles of open plains.
The buffalo was the main staple of the Plains Indians, and every portion of the buffalo provided one form of food or another.
On the way back to the village, all the hunting horses were loaded, and we little boys who could not wait for the feast helped ourselves to all the raw liver we wanted. Nobody got cross when we did this. You could see red meat hanging everywhere. The people feasted all night and danced and sang. Those were happy times. Hihakasapa, Black Elk.
For the horse brought the good life to the Sioux. But where did this magical being come from? The Spanish. Until Hernando Cortes landed in Mexico in 1519 with 16 stallions and mares, the New World had never seen a horse. When they acquired the guns from the French trappers, the warlike and newly mobile Sioux were poised to move from their ancestral lands in Minnesota onto lands traditionally held by other tribes.
It was a westward movement that resulted in the conquest of approximately a dozen tribes of other Indians. It was a movement that ended then in the early years of the 19th century with these people, the monarchs of the Northern Plains, never more than about 20,000 people and seven tribes.
But from the seven relatively small tribes of the Sioux came some of the most legendary figures in the history of the West, including the great leader and diplomat Red Cloud, the never-photographed, nearly mythical war chief Crazy Horse, and the iron-willed visionary Sitting Bull. And it was this group of tribes who would give the mighty United States Army their most stunning defeats. To other Indians, they were the Sioux, meaning enemy. To themselves, they were the Lakota, or the people. Perhaps surprisingly, this warrior culture enshrined family life.
Sioux family life was family first. Family was the key unit of Sioux life. Their nomadic ways made it necessary for every member of the family to operate as a part of the unit, or the whole thing would have failed.
The Lakota name for children is Wakayaja. Waka is sacredness. You pamper the child. The thing that really impressed upon the Lakota people was the fact that the immigrants would hit their children, and they would say they treat their children like animals, like dogs, because they beat them.
Although they could, and often did, take on more than one wife, monogamy was the norm.
The roles of man and wife were very well defined. One was not necessarily superior to another, as we might think looking from our cultural perspective. While it was the man's role to hunt and make war and manufacture the weapons and other instruments of the hunt and warfare, the woman was in charge of the teepee. And this was a society in which the woman ruled the family in the sense that it was matriarchal. When two got married, he moved in with her, even if she was from another tribe.
The notion of individual freedom was supreme for the Sioux. Many diverse behaviors were tolerated as long as they did not disrupt the well-being of the tribe.
The plains is a big bowl with a turquoise sky. And this space creates a feeling of freedom that's there. No one can live there without feeling free. And under all this beauty of the sky and the land, the Sioux were probably the most freedom-loving of tribes.
The Sioux expressed their deep spirituality through dance and music, with their most sacred ritual being a yearly ceremony of physical self-sacrifice and stoic endurance of pain, called the Sun Dance.
The thing that really strikes most people as being very sadistic is this whole notion of piercing, which the men went through. These were voluntary decisions that a man made, and he would do this because the underlying principle here is that all I have is my own body. And it was also very important to many of the men who danced because they danced for the continuation of the Lakota people.
Look at that young man. He is feeling good because his sweetheart is watching him. Sundance chant.
They were a nation of warriors who took great pride in their ability to endure pain. But at the height of their culture in mid-19th century, they would encounter a force that would bring them deeper pain than they had ever experienced. Sioux culture revolved around war. Their pictographs, sort of autobiographies or tribal histories in picture form, make their love of battle obvious.
You see a grit and realism in the Native American pictographs that white artists would never embrace for another 100 years. Whites infuse their images of Western warfare with a romance, with a light aura that glorified it. But the Indian pictographs show the horror of warfare, the torn and twisted bodies, the blood, the anguish that characterized warfare on the plains.
Going on the warpath was part of a rite of passage for males. War was the underlying principle of the Lakota people because through it, men gained prestige, and their prestige was reflected in the whole family honor.
In the mid-19th century, the new enemy that entered the Sioux's institutionalized, ritualized system of warfare was the white man. And in the space of a few decades, he brought to the plains numbers, technology, and tactics that the Sioux had never before encountered.
I think it was a case of too much hurry up, too much greed, and this belief in manifest destiny where the people of European ancestry that was their God-given right to conquer this land.
On the northern plains, much of the land that the white man wanted was land that the Sioux had fought for during the previous century and now controlled. And often that land was speckled with gold. In 1863, a scout named John Bozeman blazed a trail to the gold mines around Virginia City, Montana.
This lay right through the Powder River country, the Buffalo Range of Red Cloud's people. And it was Red Cloud who personified, gave voice to the determination of those people to resist this invasion of their hunting grounds.
The white men have crowded the Indians back year by year. And now our last hunting ground, the home of the people, is to be taken from us. Our women and children will starve. But for my part, I prefer to die fighting than by starvation. Mach Pialuta, Red Cloud.
Red Cloud and his followers made travel on the Bozeman Trail difficult and dangerous for any whites who attempted it. So in 1866, he was invited to a peace council at Fort Laramie. As the council progressed, Red Cloud realized that Colonel Henry Carrington had been assigned to build a string of forts along the Bozeman Trail to protect travelers. The proud chief was incensed.
The Great Father sends us presents and wants us to sell him the road. Before the Indians say yes or no, White Chief goes with soldiers and steals the road. Red Cloud.
Red Cloud left the council in anger, along with about half the other chiefs. But some Sioux leaders, including the powerful Spotted Tail, stayed and signed the treaty. Carrington went on to build the forts. Red Cloud raided them. Red Cloud's war was on.
What has been done in my country, I did not want, did not ask for it. White people going through my country. When the white man comes in my country, he leaves a trail of blood behind him. Red Cloud.
William J. Fetterman was the brash young army captain whose arrogance and ambition provided the prerequisites for the most dramatic incident in Red Cloud's war.
At Fort Phil Kearny was a Captain William Judd Fetterman, who had declared that with 80 men, he could ride through the whole Sioux Nation, beginning a long tradition of American Army officers who had absolute contempt for their native foes. He got his chance when sent out to protect a wood detail that had been attacked by the Sioux.
Things were not quite as they seemed for Fetterman. The ragtag band of Sioux attackers that he chased deep into the hills were in fact a decoy party led by the brilliant young war chief, Crazy Horse. The leader of the small, apparently pathetic band of Sioux suddenly shouted his war cry. Hundreds of Sioux materialized out of the trees and gullies surrounding the whites.
Fetterman and his second in command horrified the Sioux when at the climax of the battle they turned to each other and shot each other in the head.
In less than an hour, Fetterman and all his 80 men were dead. Red Cloud continued his raiding. The whites became anxious for peace. Red Cloud held his ground.
We are on the mountains, looking down on the soldiers in the forts. When we see the soldiers moving away and the forts abandoned, then I will come down and talk. Red Cloud.
In May of 1868, the army did abandon the forts along the Bozeman Trail. The Indians burned them to the ground, and Red Cloud signed a momentous peace treaty at Fort Laramie that promised exclusive use of the Powder River country to the Indians.
When he signed, the Red Cloud War was over, the Great Sioux Reservation had been created, and while I'm sure Red Cloud didn't realize it, he had promised that ultimately all of his people would settle on the Great Sioux Reservation. As it turned out, he became the most noted of all of the reservation chiefs.
The Great Spirit has made all things that I have in my country wild. I have eyes. I see all you whites, what you are doing, raising stock and so forth. I know I will have to come to that in a few years myself. It is good. Red Cloud.
Around the lands of the Sioux, with only the army forts and a few scattered settlers to remind him of the white man, Red Cloud's confidence was unshakable. When asked about his 1868 victory over the U.S. government, his response was direct.
I have more soldiers than the Great Father, and he cannot take my lands against my will. Red Cloud.
But Red Cloud would travel east to Washington, D.C. 8 times in his years as a negotiator for the Sioux. During his first visit to the white seat of power, his worldview expanded in a way that compromised his bold confidence.
Our nation is melting away like the snow on the sides of the hills where the sun is warm. Well, your people are like the blades of grass in spring when the summer is coming. Red Cloud.
The government used the Washington visit successfully on waves of Sioux and other Native American authority figures. Since most Indian tribes didn't have any strict lines of command, the United States had to deal with many leaders and sometimes even created chiefs in order to have treaty signers.
The government couldn't understand why we had so many chiefs. They were trying to talk only to one leader that will speak for all the tribes, which is impossible to do because each one of us have our own bands or our own tribes to take care of.
They were wined and dined. They went to the Smithsonian institutions and marveled at George Catlin's Indian paintings. They went to the National Zoo where Gray Eagle tried to buy a monkey.
And they were also shown the might of America and Washington's intimidating architecture. Much of the intention of these trips was to turn war chiefs into peace chiefs.
A war chief was one who had won great war honors and who would lead by example in battle. A peace chief was a chief that was more dedicated to civil affairs, and by cajoling, by seeking compromise, by bringing people together, would influence the direction of the tribal life of a band of Lakota.
Red Cloud was ready to become a peace chief. He lived on the Great Sioux Reservation, an area so large that when it was created at the 1869 treaty at Fort Laramie, it encompassed the entire western half of South Dakota. During the rest of his life, Red Cloud would watch the size of the reservation shrink dramatically.
He became really a very talented diplomat, a very talented bureaucrat, if you will, one who was able to walk that very fine line between his own people and the United States government and his agents, and to play the one off against another, and to retain his leadership and his influence into the 20th century and into old age.
The treaty that had brought Red Cloud to the reservation had also promised that a large area to the west, including the sacred Black Hills, would remain Indian land.
No white person or persons shall be permitted to settle or occupy any portion of the territory, or without the consent of the Indians to pass through same. Treaty of 1868.
But in 1874, rumors spread that gold could be found in this pristine wilderness. The government sent Major General George Custer, called Pahuska or Longhair by the Sioux, to investigate. He drove his cavalrymen and supply wagons deep into the heart of the Holy Black Hills and soon reported that they were filled with gold from the grassroots down.
I learned that Pahuska had found there much of the yellow metal that makes the whites crazy. Our people knew there was yellow metal in little chunks up there, but they did not bother with it because it was not good for anything. Black Elk.
In the Black Hills, there's gold. And the white man saw it as a money-making venture. We Indians saw it as a beautiful place where we can go and pray and to receive something perhaps that is better than the gold that is in there. A lot of our creation stories and a lot of our Indian medicine came from the Black Hills.
With the buffalo declining rapidly on the Great Plains, the Black Hills and surrounding areas were the last refuge of the Sioux. Custer's report fueled a gold rush. Miners poured into the Black Hills. Non-reservation bands of Sioux who chose to live the traditional nomadic lifestyle were threatened with arrest.
Unless they shall remove within the bounds of their reservation before the 31st of next January, they shall be deemed hostile and treated accordingly by the military force. Edward P. Smith, Commissioner of Indian Affairs, 1875.
In 1 year, these conditions would bring about the most celebrated battle in the history of the Indian Wars.
I do not propose to sell any part of my country, nor will I have the whites cutting our timber along the rivers, especially the oaks. I am particularly fond of the little groves of oak trees. I love to look at them and feel a reverence for them, because they endure in the wintry storms and the summer's heat, and not unlike ourselves, seem to thrive and flourish by them. Tatanka Iotanka, Sitting Bull.
The lifestyle was so beautiful. And yet, the white man wanted to change the Indian, brought him on a reservation. And Sitting Bull didn't want that. So that's why he gave his life for that way of life, to be an Indian.
Sitting Bull may have had more power than any other Indian leader because through the years, he built up such a large following. I think his following developed out of the fact that he wouldn't compromise.
It simply was not within Sitting Bull to surrender any portion of the freedom and the cultural autonomy that had made his people a great people and that had made him a great man among his people.
If the Sioux had the equivalent of a Renaissance man, it was Sitting Bull of the Hunkpapa tribe. Although not a hereditary chief, he was a holy man. He was a great warrior. He was a hard bargaining politician. He was a composer of songs and he was an artist. His pictographs recount the honors of a noble life destined towards a tragic end by the tumultuous times in which he lived.
The pictographs are always identified with his specific hieroglyphic, a sitting bull attached to his mouth like a bubble up here. And there are, I believe, 45 of these, which alone attest to Sitting Bull's bravery, because every one of them represents an encounter with an enemy Indian, and every one of them has been attested to by witnesses as a war honor that he is entitled to claim.
Although this particular set of pictographs relate only to his battle exploits against Indian foes, it is primarily through his antagonisms of the white man that we know Sitting Bull. His rise to notoriety started around the time the Treaty of 1868 established the Great Sioux Reservation. Sitting Bull was one leader who refused to accept the terms of the treaty, and bands of like-minded Sioux and Northern Cheyenne began to unify under him. They insisted upon living the free life and chastised those on the reservation.
You are fools to make yourselves slaves to a piece of bacon fat, some hard tack, and a little sugar and coffee. Sitting Bull.
I don't think that his followers thought of him as a chief, but rather a cultural and religious leader.
He had that ability to see visions, to understand. Others who don't understand that will immediately say, well, this guy has something and he's a mystery, so he's a medicine man. Well, he really isn't. He had the ability to foresee things, to prophesy.
Sitting Bull's most famous prophecy came during the war for the Black Hills when he called for a sun dance to be held. He had 100 bits of flesh of his arms cut out, then danced for over 24 hours.
A vision appeared to him while dancing the sun dance of soldiers falling out of the heavens upside down into the Sioux village, which was a forecast of exactly what happened scarcely a month later.
Pursued by U.S. forces, Sitting Bull's large Sioux village, some Northern Cheyenne and some Arapaho, moved camp to the river they call the Greasy Grass. Others called it the Little Bighorn. On June 25, 1876, the reckless Longhair, Major General George Armstrong Custer, led five companies of cavalry directly towards their three-mile-long encampment. Less than a mile from their mobile village, the Sioux met their invaders.
The Little Bighorn was the greatest military triumph the Sioux had ever achieved, either against the whites or against other tribes. They had been acting purely on the defensive, and they had fought only because they were directly attacked and their families were placed in jeopardy.
According to our grandmother, the battle only took about 20 minutes. That's all it took to fight Custer on.
At the Battle of the Little Bighorn, the Sioux and their allies destroyed the corps of the 7th Cavalry. Ironically, Sitting Bull, who the press would credit with winning the victory over Custer, did not participate in the main battle. The Sioux were led that day by their great war chief, Crazy Horse. Sitting Bull's contribution was profoundly spiritual.
In his vision, he already foretold that what was going to happen. And all they had to do was just carry it out. Now, we put faith in those things. This is what is going to happen. It's going to happen, and it usually does happen. And that's probably one of his greatest contributions that he ever made in that battle, was that we already knew we were going to win.
But there had been a second part to Sitting Bull's prophecy, a part that the warriors didn't heed.
These dead soldiers who are coming are a gift from Wakantanka. Kill them. But do not take their guns and horses. Do not touch the spoils. If you set your hearts upon the goods of the white man, it will prove a curse to this nation. Sitting Bull, after his sundance.
The retribution for the Great Sioux victory came with a vengeance. The U.S. Army, directed by Sherman and Crook, employed the same scorched earth policy against the Sioux that had served them so well in the American Civil War. Many men, women, and children were killed. Some of the Sioux chiefs, including Crazy Horse and his followers, surrendered. Sitting Bull took his people across the border to Canada in hopes of maintaining their traditional lifestyle.
So long as there remains a gopher to eat, I will not go back, Sitting Bull.
But after 4 years, the life was too hard. With his people facing starvation, Sitting Bull crossed the border again. At Fort Buford, he surrendered and established camp. He gave his Winchester to his son, Crowfoot, an order that he handed to the post commander.
I wish it to be remembered that I was the last man of my tribe to surrender his rifle, and this day have given it to you, Sitting Bull.
In 1883, he was moved to Standing Rock Agency, where his defiant stance put him at odds with James McLaughlin, the agency's tough administrator.
McLaughlin was a man who believed that Indians should become us white men immediately. No fooling around. I'll get you a mule and a plow and you become a farmer. And you can't imagine Sitting Bull as a farmer. He was Indian. He was going to remain Indian.
He was a stocky man with an evil face and shifty eyes. Crafty, avaricious, mendacious, and ambitious. Sitting Bull possessed all the faults of an Indian, and none of the nobler attributes which have gone far to redeem some of his people from their deeds of guilt. James McLaughlin.
Sitting Bull didn't confine himself to the reservation. In 1885, he toured with Buffalo Bill Cody's Wild West for $50 a week and made an additional dollar and a half for every picture he autographed.
He was generous in giving his money to newsboys, bootblacks, and other urchins who hung about the showgrounds. He could not understand such poverty in the midst of the white man's wealth. Don Russell, Buffalo Bill's biographer.
In 1887, Sitting Bull turned down Buffalo Bill's offer of a European tour because he sensed that the government was about to take more land away from his people. He became an uncompromising negotiator.
In one of the meetings that he had with the government, he took some dirt off the ground and he spilt it in front of them. And it's even this much land I will not sell. He did not trust those people. So he personally never signed any treaty.
In 1888, Sitting Bull went to Washington with a large delegation of chiefs to negotiate the sale of 10 million acres of Sioux reservation land to the government. Because of his hard-line position, the selling price rose from 50 cents an acre to $1.25. Enough of the other chiefs signed to validate the agreement. Sitting Bull did not.
Indians! There are no Indians left but me. Sitting Bull.
Sitting Bull went back to his family on Standing Rock Reservation.
I am the lonely wolf, wandering pretty nearly all over the world. He, he. Sitting Bull's song.
The defiant leader of the Sioux had a final tragic role to play in the sweeping drama that was reaching its climax on the northern Great Plains. A role that involved another prophecy. A meadowlark told him, he said, that the Sioux would kill him. The freedom-loving Sioux found reservation life prison-like and nearly intolerable.
Within the span of a decade, these people truly did verge on a total cultural breakdown. And it was this sense of demoralization, this sense of collapse of everything that had given meaning to their lives that provided such a fertile soil for the flowering of the ghost dance religion in 1890.
This revivalistic religion had its origin in Nevada, but appealed to all Indians throughout the West who were seeing their cultures vanish. Its prophet was a Paiute mystic named Rivoca, who had a vision of salvation during an eclipse of the sun.
All Indians must dance. Everywhere, keep on dancing. Pretty soon, in the next spring, Great Spirit come. He bring back all game of every kind. All dead Indians come back and live again. All the Indians go to the mountains. high up away from the whites. Then, big flood comes like water, and all white people die. Wabuka.
Short Bull and Kicking Bear were two Sioux who met with Revoca in Nevada and became disciples of the new religion. At Sitting Bull's invitation, Kicking Bear brought the ghost dance to Standing Rock Reservation.
Sitting Bull embraced Kicking Bear's teachings, ostensibly at least, although there is some question the depth of his genuine commitment and belief in it. But Sitting Bull functioned then as the chief apostle of the ghost dance on the Standing Rock Reservation.
On the banks of the Grand River, in the shadow of Sitting Bull's cabin, the Sioux performed the ghost dance with an added militaristic element. They claimed that their ghost shirts would stop bullets. Agent James McLaughlin was furious.
The excitement was very intense. The people were permitted to dance until they dropped. And this daily performance, with very little food, had made them subjects for the madhouse. James McLaughlin.
McLaughlin demanded that the dancing stop. Sitting Bull wouldn't comply. McLaughlin ordered Sitting Bull's arrest.
A very cagey man. He used the Indian again. The Indian was used. He rounded up 30, 40 men. Indian warriors and commissioned them as Indian police officers and said, here, you go do the job.
Lieutenant Bullhead led the arrest party to Sitting Bull's cabin. With him was Sergeant Red Tomahawk. They rousted Sitting Bull from his sleep before dawn on December 15th, 1890.
Catch the Bear, who was a mortal enemy of Bullhead, burst forth with his Winchester rifle and shot Bullhead in the chest. As Bullhead fell, he turned his own pistol upward and shot Sitting Bull in the chest. And at exact same moment, Sergeant Red Tomahawk shot Sitting Bull in the back of the head, and then just all hell broke loose. They all started firing at each other at very close range.
Six Indian policemen and seven of Sitting Bull's followers, along with Crowfoot, Sitting Bull's son, died along with the great leader on that cold morning. Another of Sitting Bull's prophecies had come true. He had been killed by Sioux.
A really tragic finale to this whole senseless confrontation, because the Indian policemen had relatives among those firing at them. And Indian policemen had just shot down and killed the greatest Sioux chief ever.
Somebody comes in the middle of the night and raises a cane with you and kills you, and kills your son, which happened at the same place, then the rest of them would run. And that's exactly what happened. They ran from that place, they ran to Cherry Creek, South Dakota, in that area where Bigfoot was.
38 of Sitting Bull's followers joined Chief Bigfoot and his band of nearly 300.
The death of Sitting Bull created a tremendous amount of turmoil and apprehension among all the different sub-tribes of the Sioux. And they wanted to get away from any place where there were soldiers.
Under the orders of General Nelson Miles, the 7th Cavalry apprehended Bigfoot and moved him and his clearly armed band to Wounded Knee Creek. The cavalry surrounded the Indians and set up heavy artillery Hotchkiss guns on a hill above the encampment. The situation was ripe for disaster.
Women and the ones in their tents, they said they can't sleep because they're scared. And all that time, the soldiers were, 7th Cavalry soldiers were drinking, having party.
In the morning, the cavalry demanded that the Sioux surrender their weapons. A shot rang out.
Neither side intended an explosion that simply happened because of rising tensions that could no longer be contained. When it did burst forth, it was a terrible, violent, hand-to-hand conflict that took the lives of many Indians and many soldiers and ended with an infuriated soldiery on the hill turning loose with artillery that cut down men, women, and children and leveled the entire village of Bigfoot.
My grandfather, Dewey Beard, they killed his wife and the baby stayed with him overnight. So baby got sick and died. And they don't come out of there as a family. They were killed.
I was badly wounded. While I was lying on my back, I looked down the ravine and saw these women and little girls and boys coming up. I saw soldiers on both sides of the ravine shoot at them until they killed every one of them. Dewey Beard.
When it was over, nearly 180 of the Lakota lay dead, including Chief Bigfoot. They were left for 3 days while snow swelled around them. Then civilians were hired to bury the Sioux in mass graves for $2 a body.
The result is what still lives today in the memories both of the Indians and the whites, and that is of women and children torn apart by artillery on that frozen, snow-covered field of wounded knee. And so history, dispassionate, objective history, inevitably gives way to that vivid memory and all that it has meant for the Indian people over the years. And it is something that both cultures still have to grapple with today.
I can still see the butchered women and children lying heaped and scattered along the crooked gulch as plain as when I saw them with eyes still young. And I can see that something else died there in the bloody mud and was buried in the blizzard. A people's dream died there. Black Elk.